I need a spring for the clutch mechanism. Finding one that's the correct length is the problem. This one is 5/16 outside diameter, and they measure that from here to here, being 2 13/16. I need one that's about half that length. If you carefully mark the center, and then go in there and unwrap a couple of these coils without distorting the spring. I'm going to cut that right here and form a new eye on the end of the spring. If you're careful and have a reasonable assortment of pliers, you can form an end on there without breaking that wire. This is carbon steel or piano wire. After I tried this, I found they were still too long and I shortened them again. The coil length is about 9/16, and that puts good pressure between the Hoover belt and the drive disc for the take-up spool. This is a 3/8 inch diameter aluminum rod. It's 7 5/8 inches long. It was drilled and tapped for 8/32 on this end and for 6/32 on that end. When I install this, I will then drill a couple of holes in here, and I'll show you what those are for in a moment. The idler disc mounts on one end. You can see it turns very freely. And then there's a 6/32 countersunk machine screw that goes into the other end. The rod then goes through this hole that's in the back of the pressure box. This plywood block is attached to the back of the pressure box with two screws. You can cut a square hole in here. This is 1/2 inch square. You can do that with the scroll saw. I used a dedicated mortiser and a 1/2 inch bit to drill a square hole through there, and that will be for the clutch lever. That aluminum rod has two holes drilled in it. This is a 6/32 bolt that's 1.5 inches long, and I drilled a hole in the end of it so I could attach the spring. On the other end of this bolt, on the other side of this rod, is a nut, and I can adjust that nut up and down, which will vary the spring tension, so I can adjust how much pressure is on that idler disc. The clutch lever has a finishing nail epoxied into the end of it, and I've cut a notch in this lever. That finishing nail engages that hole in the rod. Now I can push that rod up and down. If I push down on this and pull it towards me, it disengages the idler disc. If I put it back the other way, the spring pulls it back up and puts load against the idler disc. And I have filed or sanded the end of this rod to be just a little bit curved so that it's not exactly flat. That allows that rod to move a little bit. The aluminum rod continues through and then butts up against the front of the pressure box. That machine screw with the countersunk head screws into the end of that rod. You run that into the end of the rod and you tighten it up towards it's just tight, and then you back it off a little bit. So when you push up and down on that clutch lever, that rod is pivoting at this point. The clutch lever pushes the idler disc up and down. When it's up, it is spring-loaded against this friction wheel so that when the crankshaft turns, it's turning the idler disc, and the idler disc is turning this drive disc for the take-up spool. When I push the lever down and lock it disengaged, the idler freewheels and the take-up spool freewheels so you can rewind the music. When you engage it again, it'll drive the disc. There's no reason to have any more spring pressure against this disc than what it takes to drive this without slipping. When this is engaged with the spring, I can hold this disc and turn the crankshaft in the correct direction. As I turn that, it's trying to pick up on this idler disc, and it just makes everything get tighter. So you only want that spring just tight enough for everything to work. If it's too loose, then the music is going to sound funny because this will start slipping. the length of that rod has to be correct, and you adjust the position of this drive disc in and out on this quarter inch shaft so that Hoover belt is running perfectly in that groove.